Well, praise the Lord. Good morning. Welcome to Abundant Grace Church. This is the day the Lord has made, and we are to rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. So I'm glad you're joining us this morning. Gather around with your family, get your Bible, get some things to take some notes, and come expecting to hear from the Lord this morning. Amen. As always, please check our website, abundantgracechurch.com. There are, you can click on that COVID-19 response link right on the front of the page. And there's information updated concerning what we're doing and how we're conducting our services here. We are continuing to do it live stream only, no in-person gatherings at this time. And we're going to reevaluate about February 11th. Again, check it, because that's where we're going to be putting out most of our information. Amen. How many came ready to worship the Lord? The Lord is good. Amen. I'm so thankful to be in the truth this morning, and so we're going to worship the Lord a couple songs, and we're going to get right into the Word. Amen? Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for this time together, Lord. We do. We honor you. We worship you. We thank you that we are in covenant with the King, Father, that redemption is ours, and though we have sinned and turned it over to Satan, 2,000 years ago, Jesus came and made a plan for us, and we thank you for our redemption, that we are no longer lost, but we are found. Hallelujah. So we're going to sing this amazing love.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. Spirit lives within me because you died and rose again.
Let's sing that again. I'm forgiven. Thank him for your forgiveness.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. Spirit lives within me because you died and rose again.
Hallelujah, Lord, let's sing it.
Amazing love, tell me how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love. Because you were forsaken, I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit lives within me because you died and rose. Amazing love, tell me how can it be you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, now I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all.
Amazing love.
Amazing love. Tell me how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love. Now I know it's true. It's my joy to
King.
You are my King. You are my King.
Yes, you are.
You are my King.
Thank you, Lord.
You
thank you for your amazing love. We are forgiven, Father. Hallelujah. Because of what Jesus did, we've been brought near by the blood. And it's an honor and it's a joy to worship you, Father. Thank you, Lord.
Of sin and grave,
Hallelujah, Lord, we worship you. Glory, 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 glory. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you for your presence. Wherever you're at, just lift your hands and worship him. The anointing is here, and it's present, his glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Father, we worship you. We thank you for your word today. Thank you for this opportunity that we had to worship and to honor you and to hear your word today. So may you be glorified in all that's said and done, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Angie. Well, the Lord is good. He is wonderful to us. How many are fighting the good fight of faith? That's what we're called to do, right? To fight the good fight of faith. Not to lay down and whine and complain, but we are being tried by fire. And, you know, that seems negative when you're going through it, but you never see the pureness until it's been tested with fire. And I believe that the church is going through a fire trial at this point. But don't lose hope. This is not the time to give up. This is not the time to quit. It's not the time to grow weary or complacent. This is a time to dig in with both heels and understand that you're coming through this and you're going to shine. And the glory of the Lord is going to be revealed through you, to you, and to the rest of this world and through the church. And it's the greatest time to be alive. So we are excited, and we're not thinking that it's strange like Scripture tells us, the fiery trials that we're going through right now, but to God be the glory. Amen. He hasn't forgotten us. You know, sometimes people think the Lord is being real silent right now. And listen, he gave us his word. He's given us his word, and that's all we need is his word. And guess what? When it seems as though he's being silent, that's not the time to let up. That's the time to dig in and for us to stay abiding in the vine. Stay on the branch. Amen. Glory to God. Well, it's time for our time to give and sow our seed. And again, we certainly appreciate the partnership and everybody who's been sowing seed. I just want to let you know this, that when you sow your seed in obedience to wherever God's directing you to do so, the local church where you're being fed, you are sowing seed into fertile, good ground. And so you can, everything that we do and everything that we sow into and everything that we're, how we're ministering and doing things has an effect on you. It affects you because you're sowing into it. And so I want to encourage you. This is not the time to grow weary. This is not the time to get slack. This is not the time to fear. What's the economy doing? Doesn't matter what the economy is doing, because God's economy is still in great shape, and it always will be. So we need to lay hold. Sow seed in faith. Sow seed in obedience. Okay? Thank the Lord, we sow it in faith, but we reap in faith. We command the enemy to take his hands off of our finances, off our provision. Friend, everything that we need is here. It's on this planet Earth already. God is our source, our one and only. Thank God. But he uses multiple channels all throughout this world. And so you continue to water your seed. You continue in faith, speaking over it, thanking God that the ministering spirits are going forth, causing it to come. That any channel that God is using, that they're quick. And you know what? When you do that, I always do this as well. Father, make me a channel. Make me a channel. I want to do it quick. If someone else is believing for something, Father, tap me. I'm the one. I'll sow. And it continues to perpetuate. And in doing so, the Bible says that that he rebukes the devourer, God the Father, for our sake. And he causes increase to come into our lives. So this is not the time to back off just because we might not be in person. We're doing a lot here at the church. And we got some exciting things. And I can tell you this right now, by the Spirit of the Lord and impressed in my heart, that the greater days and the greater glory are just in front of us. So if we'll continue going through this trial by fire, God is going to manifest his glory in the church. And so we're still doing things here. We're feeding countless number of families on a daily basis every week. And we've been doing this since this pandemic started. And we're so thankful for our partners and different resources throughout the state and the community that have sown into this. And we're touching people's lives. You have a part to play in it. When you sow, You are benefiting. You are part of the reward that's coming in. And so I can, you know, encourage you, and I say it all the time, the most important thing you can do is to obey God. When he prompts you to do it, be quick, be willing, be happy to do it, because he's setting you up for blessing. Amen. But you got to do it in faith, because sometimes you look, don't look, just listen. Do it and listen. And so if you want to know how you can give this morning, it's on our screens, but I'll let you know. You could text your offering to 732-856-5050. That's the quickest and easiest way. You can continue to mail a check if you want to. You could drop one off, or you can go to our website at abundantgracechurch.com, and there's a giving tab, and you can give that way as well. Either way, do it in faith, do it quickly, and do it willingly and happily. And the Lord promises that he'd bless and multiply our seed, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I believe that, and I know you do. So let's pray over our offering this morning, and then let's sow it in faith with a willing heart, glad to do it. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you that you are the one who gives us the ability to gain increase and to get wealth, to be able to work, Father. Our jobs are not our source. Our retirement plans are not our source, Father. You are our source. And as we're in tune to your Spirit and obey the Holy Ghost on the inside, you will show us what to do, what to invest in, where to go, how to do it, Father. You'll impress upon our hearts where to give, what to give, Father, bringing the tithe, and above and beyond, sowing our offerings, Father. I speak a blessing as an under-shepherd of this congregation here and those who are watching. I speak a blessing over your life today. Be blessed. 30, 60, 100-fold return on your giving as you sow in faith. Father, I thank you that you rebuke the devourer for our sake. You cause continued increase to come into our life. Provision, Father, provision, so that we would lack nothing. Thoroughly furnished, Father, fully equipped, lacking nothing, that we would do everything in a high and excellent fashion as unto you, Lord, that you are reducing our debts, eliminating and reducing our debts, Father. You're meeting every need according to your riches and glory. Every bill paid, every debt reduced and eliminated, Father. We thank you for the property that you're giving us. We thank you for the vehicles that you're getting to us. We thank you for all the equipment that we need, Father, the houses and the land, so that we can do what you want done, because the greatest times are in front of us, and we know that the greatest influx into the church and believers is about to happen, and it's about to happen through us. And so, Father, we confidently expect that. We thank you for your blessing. Thank you that you bless every person that sows today in faith, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. Thanks again for being obedient. It's the most important thing that we can do. Amen. Well, glory to God. Let's get into the Word this morning. You remember what we talked about last week? If you weren't here with us last week and you didn't get to see it, we've been started a series. What do we call it? Staying in the race. Yes, staying in the race. And the Lord is helping us. He's giving us direction, and the Holy Ghost is leading us. And I would encourage you. I mean, we have all of our services recorded, so you can go to our website again and view them. It'll take you to our YouTube channel from our website, and you can go back and view and listen over and over again to every one of our messages, our Wednesday evening services, our Sunday mornings, and our faith and healing classes Tuesday through Friday. How does faith come? How does faith come? Faith comes by hearing. Is it important what you hear? Will faith come by hearing negative news? Certainly won't. Fear will come, but faith comes to us by hearing the anointed word of Christ. It's so important what we're feeding on, what we're hearing. And just like food to our natural body gives us strength, his word is food to our spirits, and it strengthens us. And it sustains us. Proverbs says that the strong spirit of a person sustains them during affliction, sickness, during depression, during those times of lack. A strong spirit. Why do you need a strong spirit? Because if you're weak, you're going to respond. You're going to respond from your flesh. You're going to respond from your emotions. And you're going to look at things from a natural standpoint. But if we're led by the Spirit, There's life and peace and joy, and there's provision. So it's important, but we need to feed our spirit. So why don't we do this? Let's release faith together right now as we study the word this morning and prepare our hearts to receive. Father, we thank you for your word. Your word is anointed, Father. The anointing is on your word. Your word is life to us. It's a light to our feet. It's a lamp unto our path, Father. And we thank you that as your word enters our heart, it gives us revelation knowledge, Father. It gives us impartations of truth. It helps us to clearly see what we need to do and where we need to make adjustments in our life. And so as we study it today, Father, we ask the Holy Spirit to teach, to speak through me, Father, clearly, accurately, precisely what you want spoken, Father. You know what every one of us need to hear today. And so we release faith, we keep that switch of faith turned on, and we fully expect to hear and then do what you're speaking to us. Father, to you be all the glory, in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. So our text has been Hebrews chapter 12. Let's look at that real quick. Hebrews 12, that has been our text. So we're going to look at that. And then I want to just recap a little bit about what we talked about last week, and then we'll get into this next part. But Hebrews chapter 12, beginning in the first verse, and I'm reading this from the Amplified, so you can follow along. It says, "Therefore, then, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses who have borne testimony to the truth, those who have gone before us, let us strip off and throw aside every encumbrance." Now, I'm not going to go and teach through all this again. Go back and listen to them, because we went over all these things, encumbrances, and what it means to lay things aside. But he's telling us, let us strip it off, throw it aside, every encumbrance, the unnecessary weight, and that sin which so readily and deftly and cleverly clings to and entangles us. Did you hear that? So easily, the sin is readily and cleverly clinging to us and entangle us. And then he tells us, run with patient endurance and steady and active persistence the appointed course of the race that is set before us. See, God has a specific race for each and every one of us. I mean, Paul, throughout the epistles, and in Timothy, talks about the Christian life. He starts off he talks about an athlete and how an athlete trains. Then he talks about a farmer, you know, and then he talks about a soldier. And all three of those are hardworking, diligent, committed individuals. If they are going to receive the victor's crown, then they're going to have to be committed to it. We have to be committed to this race. And we've talked about saying how it's staying in the race, because there are so many things that want to get us out of this race. Number one, the enemy does not want you to finish your race. He does not want you to be successful, but he has nothing to do with it if you don't yield to him. Doesn't mean he's not going to try. He's certainly going to try. But if we'll walk in the Spirit, what does the scripture tell us in Galatians? Walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lusts or the desires or the cravings of the flesh. But we have something that we have to do. We have to lay aside these things. Then verse 2, and run our race that is set before us. Verse 2 says this, looking away from all that will distract, to Jesus, who is the leader and the source of our faith, giving the first incentive for what we believe. And he is also its finisher, bringing it to maturity and perfection. He, for the joy of obtaining the prize that was set before him, he endured the cross. He despised and ignored the shame, and is now seated at the right hand of the throne of God. So, friend, this is important for us to consistently meditate upon these things. So as I was reading and praying yesterday and you know, to see where we were going to continue here and how the Lord wanted to direct this, we left off last week, and I believe it was, we talked about eight things, right? That eight tests for Christian conduct, if you remember those. And for time's sake, again, we're not going to go through and teach on those again, but I would encourage you to go back and listen to them, because there were eight things that we talked about. We had talked about the encumbrances is what we were talking about last week. Sinful things, secondary type things. And we gave, I gave you this quote from, from John MacArthur. And he said, it is something that is not necessarily bad in itself. We're talking about secondary things. It is something that is not necessarily bad in itself. Often it is something perfectly innocent and harmless. But it weighs us down, it diverts our attention, it saps our energy, dampens our enthusiasm for the things of God. And we went in great detail how, and through the scriptures, looking at 1 Corinthians 10 and 1 Corinthians 6, how Paul said, you know, all things are lawful for me, but not all things are expedient, or not all things are going to be a help, especially to my faith. And so we want to avoid those things. So we were talking about that. Those were secondary things. But today we want to talk about sorrowful things. Now we're going to go into this a little bit because as I was praying, the Lord gave me a lot more direction and some revelation yesterday when I was reading and studying 2 Timothy. Just to give you a little history on 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy, they were written about 5 years apart from each other. 1 Timothy was, if you read through it, the church was booming. It was great. People were excited about the things of God. They were coming to church, and everyone was excited. Everything was going well. The church was growing. The numbers were increasing on a daily basis. And then 5 years or 6 years later, when Paul writes the second letter to Timothy, he's writing to him to encourage him because something has happened, which is completely opposite of what was happening in the first letter. In 2 Timothy, if you read through it, there was a rebellion in the church because they were under direct opposition. They were being threatened. They were being beaten. They were being killed, persecuted. Nero was so demented and hated the Christian faith so much that he burned down Rome. He burned the whole place down, the city, and then blamed it on the Christians so that the people would obviously turn against Christianity. And then he would take those professing Christians, and they were building the road to Rome and so that they could work through the night. I'm just giving you a little bit of history. So that they could work through the night, they would take the bodies of the believers that they killed and light them like torches to keep the roadway lit so that they can work through the night. So I haven't seen any believers being burned at the stake so that they could work on the highway. So we certainly are not under that type of persecution. But sorrowful things. We are beginning to enter a phase of darkness and risky business, if you will, for the church. And if we're not sold out and perfected and walking circumspectly in his word, it's going to be easy to be swayed. And we're going to look at this. And so that's what 2 Timothy really is about. And Timothy was under such pressure that his congregation were deserting him by the boatload. They were all leaving. Why? Some were leaving because they were listening to false teaching. Some were leaving because they couldn't deal with the pressure and the persecution. And so Paul is encouraging Timothy to hang in there, continue in the fight. This is not the time to quit. And you know what? Those words are just as important as if they were spoken 10 minutes ago, because we are as a nation, as a race, as people in a society, we are living in the last of the last days. And the enemy knows this. And he's trying his darn and his best to assault the church and to get people to renege and to quit and to bail out. But we're not going to do that. We refuse to do it. We're strong soldiers, and we know how to fight the good fight of faith. So another area of concern, and honestly, it may have been the primary thought in Paul's mind when he penned this portion of Scripture. In verse 3 of Hebrews chapter 12, he says, "For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds." You hear that? Faint in your minds. Where does the battle? We've talked about this quite a bit. Where does the battle take place? We all know. The battle takes place in our mind. It comes through a suggestion. It comes through hearing something and then you create some image of it. It comes from somebody saying something, an emotion. And I'm not saying that these things aren't real. They're very real. When people say hurtful things to you, when you see things that you shouldn't see, when you hear things that you shouldn't hear, that's real. Okay? That's real. And it creates a stronghold in your mind. And that's where the enemy... So what do? We have to guard our minds. We have to put on our helmet of salvation, put on our armor, so that we do not grow weary and faint in our minds. Now, the book of Hebrews was written to Jewish Christians who were struggling with staying with the Lord and committed to Him. The reason for their struggle was that they were being persecuted by non-believing Jewish friends and family. You know, you may be enduring persecution right now from friends and family. And friend, this is not the time to give up on God and to quit your faith. This is a time to stick it out, because these same people that are persecuting you, when the glory of the Lord starts to be, and it's not if, it's when it's going to happen, when it starts to be revealed, these same people that are persecuting you are going to come to you. Some will, some may not, but the majority will, because the scriptures tell us that there's going to be a multitude of people who come into the faith. So these same people are going to come to you for help and for answers. The temptation was to think that it's not worth it. This is the Hebrews throughout the book of Hebrews. Their temptation was to think it's not worth it. This isn't worth it. Life was easier when I just did what everyone else is doing. Do you hear what I'm saying? Is that the easy way? Yes. The flesh loves easy, loves comfort, not realizing that it's sacrificing good for a quick ease of pressure. But we're not of those people who draw back and quit. We are strong. We are soldiers. We are farmers. We are athletes. We are children of God. So, you begin to say life was easier when I just did what everyone else was doing. Or maybe I should return to the living way I did before I became a Christian. This is sorrowful things. Then he warns them, Paul warns them about becoming weary and fainting in their minds. Fainting in their minds. Where is the battle? We all know it. We've been there. I could tell you, I've been there before. It could get so hot and heavy and piled up, and that's what the enemy loves to do. One blow after another. When those things are happening, if you're not diverting your attention back to the Word, you will grow weary and faint in your mind. You will. You'll start responding to the situations from the flesh and make a bigger mess out of things than it was even before. But if we'll allow the Lord, the battle is His, allow Him to fight, then we're going to stay right on point and on course. So he warns about being weary and fainting in your minds. Interestingly enough, the word race, we're talking about running our race, staying in the race. The word race in this passage, okay, in this particular passage, is the Greek word where we get our English word agony. Agony. Has anyone felt like you're in agony? you think to yourself, man, I don't know if I could take any more of this. This is getting ridiculous. Depending on the situation, it refers race now. We're talking about race, staying in our race, okay? Or don't give up just because it gets hard, okay? It refers to a conflict or a fight. Which brings us to what the Lord was speaking to me about yesterday, starting in 2 Timothy chapter, where are we at? Chapter 4, and I'm going to start in verse 3. This is important. I want us to hear this. The fight is a spiritual fight. Did you hear me? It's a spiritual fight. So if it's a spiritual fight, and what do I mean by that? It's not fighting, although it's being perpetuated by human people, okay, or situations. It is has a spiritual underlying tone to it, because it's designed by our enemy. The spirit of darkness, the principalities, the powers of the air, the scriptures tell us in Ephesians. So this fight that we are fighting, this agony, is not against people. We cannot fight and lash out at people and respond that way. Now, I'm telling you from experience that that's much easier said than done, because the temptation to blow your top is very real. And now sometimes we do, and then we feel awful and convicted afterwards. And God is so merciful, and he's so gracious, and he forgives us. But let's not make that mistake. Let's not blow our top. Let's stay ahead of our enemy. Because every time, what that's doing is you're making progress. You take one step forward to take two steps back. If every time the enemy, we blow our top and we respond from the flesh, okay, we have just given ground to the enemy. And then we have to repent, we start over, but let's stop starting over. Let's keep taking some ground and winning some battles. Amen. So it is a spiritual battle. So I'm going to read here from the Amplified and 2 Timothy chapter 4, and we're going to start in verse 3. And I'm going to go through some of this. And I would really read 2 Timothy. It has everything to do with the church and our time that we're living in right now. Even though it was written 2,000 years ago, it's as if the Holy Spirit just spoke it now. Amen. And he did. He spoke it through Paul then, inspired by God. So verse 3 says this. Listen, this is so important. And for time's sake, you know, I'd like to read the whole chapter to you, but we'll just start right here, jump in verse 3. It says, "For the time is coming when people will not tolerate, endure sound and wholesome instruction." I think we're there. I think clearly we could see that. "But having ears itching for something pleasing and gratifying, they will gather to themselves one teacher after another to a considerable number, chosen to satisfy their own liking and to foster the errors that they hold." In other words, that when a preacher of truth, like I'm preaching right now, God's word, inspired from the Holy Ghost, when you begin to teach these things, it grates people because we're challenged that we either got to make some adjustments or we could say that's heresy. So what do they do? He's talking, he said, the time is coming where people won't endure sound teaching and truth. So they go and find some hypocrisy somewhere because it pleases what they want to hear. You know, I mean, you could find someone to tell you whatever you want and they'll charge you money and you pay them. And you're like, wow, that's great. Why is it great? Because they're saying exactly what you want them to say. So, but this is, the Bible talks about false teaching, false doctrine. It says, verse 4, "And then we'll turn aside from hearing the truth and wander off into myths and man-made fictions." Do we see that today? Oh my goodness, it's all over the place. It's all over the place. Verse 5, this is us. This is our command. Now, this is Paul talking to Timothy, but it's the Holy Ghost today talking to you and talking to me. As for you, he just gave you what's going on. "As for you, be calm and cool and steady." I love that. I love the Amplified. "Be calm, be cool, and be steady. Accept and suffer unflinchingly every hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Fully perform all the duties of your ministry." Of your ministry. "For I am already about to be sacrificed." This is Paul. "My life is about to be poured out as a drink offering. The time of my spirit's release from the body is at hand, and I will soon go free." In verse 7, he says, "I have fought the good, worthy, honorable, and noble fight. I have finished the race." Again, in other words, we said race is the same Greek word where we get agony or conflict or a fight. He said, "I have fought the good fight, the worthy, honorable, and noble fight. I have finished the race. I have kept firmly held to the faith. As to what remains," verse 8, I love this. "As to what remains," he says, "this is what's ahead for me. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the victor's crown of righteousness, the crown of righteousness, for being right with God and doing right, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me and recompense me on that great day. And not to me only, Timothy, but also to all those who have loved and yearned for and welcomed his appearing and his return. Friend, there is a time that is coming, and we are in it now. So what are we talking about? What are we talking about? We're talking about girding up the loins of our mind. These types of things, when the world and society and your friends and your family and your workplace says to do it this way, the Bible says that they're going to be calling evil good and good evil. What are we going to do when we're faced with that? Are we going to blend in and side with them because of convenience sake? Or are we going to fight the good fight of faith? You know, if we'll stay on God's side, we win every single time. But this is what's going on. Timothy said, I have fought the good fight of faith. I wanted to read this one verse of scripture to you, 2 Timothy chapter 3 in the first verse, because I like the way it's written here. He says, understand this, that in the last days, and we're in the last days, that in the last days will come perilous times of great stress and trouble, hard to deal with and hard to bear. You might be feeling that right now. And if you are, it's confirming God's word. But it's not the time for the Christian soldier or athlete to bail out. This is a time where all the training that we've had and all the word that we've put in, this is a time for us to put that word and that training into practice. Not a time to quit. Not a time to quit, but a time to go after it even harder. And how do we overcome? By staying in God's word, by listening to the Holy Ghost. These dark times and these risky times that are hard to bear, the Holy Spirit is going to, if you'll listen to him, if you'll take the time and really listen to him and not just respond from your flesh and get irritated and get fearful and just do things, but if you'll take the time when you're tempted to do that, because the temptation to do it's going to come, but when you are, don't do it. Open up the Bible and begin to read some of these scriptures. And as you do, the Holy Spirit will show you and quicken you and talk to you and show you how you can make it around all that peacefully and victoriously. I believe that. I believe that, and I pray that you believe it as well, because that's how the glory of God is going to be revealed through the church. If we all resort to doing the things that the world does and resort to responding to problems and difficulties from our flesh, then there's going to be no church for God to reveal his glory through. But again, I've said this, why are we born at this time? We could have been born at any point in the history of humanity. But God saw fit that we were born at this time, which tells me there's something in this generation, this present group of believers, that has what is needed to endure in these last days. And I'm thankful to God. It's by his Spirit living inside of me. We can't do anything in and of ourselves, but in Christ we can do all things. But that comes down to, what did the Lord say? What did Jesus say to his disciples? He said, don't fear. He said, you know, soon I'm going away, and where I'm going, you can't come. And they're like, what? What do you mean? We just spent 3 years with you. You did everything for us, and now you're just going to leave? You can't leave us. He said, don't despair. He said, it's more important that I go, because I'm going to send you the Comforter, the Helper, the Holy Ghost. And I'm so thankful for the Holy Ghost. And you know, his job, his specific job, and he's a real person, is to help us, to encourage us, to strengthen us, to lead us, to quicken us, to coach us through life, to navigate. See, he's been here and done it. So it's like he knows where to turn. He knows where to go. But the sad thing is, there's far too many Christians that just do not access what's been given to them, the help that's available. You know, I wake up in the morning and I purposely, and I'm not saying that every time throughout the day that I don't miss it or I fail to, I should have checked with the Holy Spirit about that. But for the most part, I'm doing better and better at it. But I get up in the morning and I just like I'm talking to him, I turn and I look as if he's standing here and I say, Holy Spirit, I acknowledge you today. I recognize what your job is, why you came. So I'm asking you to do it. Help me. I'm going to look to you. I'm not just going to go fly off the handle and do what I want. I want to be led by you today. And thank God he does that. And he's not a bully. He doesn't push his way in. It's still, it's small, it's quiet, it's respectful. But if you listen to it, you're going to do the right thing every time. Glory to God. Hard to bear. Times that are hard to bear. So what are we fighting? What are we fighting? And for who are we fighting? This is the fight of faith. It is our faith and trust in God. Who are we fighting? And this is why I said this before. Let's look at Ephesians. Let's turn over to Ephesians chapter 6. You have your Bible. Take a look at this. You guys, the Lord's helping us today, right? We're getting some things. Thank God. This is helping us to do what we need to do. Ephesians chapter 6. Let's look at this. You know, the very first verse here, I want to look at verse 10, and this is all about the armor of God. But the very first verse says this, children. Now, we think of children as little children, which is right. But God looks at us as children. Looks at us as children. He considers us children. We know so little. And God knows so much. Just like as a parent, certainly know a lot more than your two-year-old does, you know. But, and you want what's best for them, and, you do everything for them. God looks at us as children. He does. He says, come to me as a little child does, childlike faith. And so he loves us, just like we love our children, but, we're especially more helpful to the needs of a two-year-old than we are of our 20-year-old. You know, the 20-year-old, if they want to act like a two-year-old, we don't let them get away with that, nor we should. We shouldn't let them get away with that. There's responsibility and accountability that they need to have. But a two-year-old, you're a lot more lenient with. God looks at us as children. Thank God he does. And he is merciful, and he is gracious to us, and he does treat us as such. Otherwise, we'd have been wiped out a long time ago. But he is. So this opens up with, children, obey your parents in the Lord as his representatives, for this is just and right. Honor, esteem, and value as precious your father and your mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, that all may be well with you and that you may live long on the earth. Live long on the earth. He just showed us, real simple, how that process is supposed to happen. Friends, as a society and a nation, we have gotten so far away from them first three verses that we don't even know how to spell respect anymore. There's no regard. For anything. I mean, I just choose for myself not to watch much of the news because it's very discouraging and it could really weigh on you. And I just happened this morning, I got up early and I flipped on the news, and I'm telling you, I turned it off so fast because I don't even know what's going on with politics. I don't care about any of that. But this one thing, there were several, and I'm saying this because we've gotten away from this. God has become obsolete in our society. The church needs to bring the message of hope and shine it for all to see. What they said on the news overnight or Saturday or whatever it was, in three different states across the U.S., teenagers, 14-year-olds, I don't know if anybody saw this, killed people. Not, some axe murder. 14-year-olds kills an Uber Eats driver just because they wanted her cell phone, 31 years old. Then then two other teenage girls killed a 15-year-old girl, stabbed her in Walmart while they streamed it on Facebook. Why am I saying this? And I'm not saying this to glorify the enemy. There's a real enemy that hates humanity. These are things that you've never heard of. Children are not obeying their parents. Some of them don't even know their parents. Do we have a job to do? I'm saying this because this is what our society is looking like. And guess what? The Bible has prophesied that this is going to happen. That the love for humanity, the love for people is going to grow so cold that it means nothing to take somebody else's life. All for your own. Why? Because they wanted a cell phone. And it is the devil. Now, why am I saying that? Because our battle is not people. It's not flesh and blood. Although you see what they do and it makes your skin curl, but there's a spiritual problem here. The principalities and the powers of the air are ruling and reigning, and believers have the authority to bind those things and to take authority and to break their power. But if we don't do that, the enemy gets to run rampant. But if the church does, the Bible says whatever is bound on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever is loosed on earth is loosed in heaven. The scriptures also tell us that humble yourself, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. He will flee. Friend, there's no greater time for the church to rise and shine and to get serious about this word and about our mission than now. Then there's no other greater moment in the history of our world than right now than to press into the things of God. So what is the battle? Who are we fighting? Who are we fighting? I'm going to tell you right now. Verse 10. In conclusion, you read verse 1 through 9 here, and you can see what he's talking about. In conclusion, be strong in the Lord. Be empowered through your union with him. Draw your strength from him. That strength which his boundless might provides. Verse 11. Put on God's whole armor, the armor of a heavy armed soldier, which God supplies, that you may be able successfully to stand up against all the strategies and the deceits of the devil. Verse 12. Now here it is. Who are we fighting? For we are not wrestling, we are not fighting with flesh and blood, contending only with physical opponents, but against the despotisms, against the powers, against the master spirits who are the world rulers of this present darkness, against the spirit forces of wickedness in the heavenly supernatural sphere. Therefore, he says, put on God's complete armor that you may be able to resist and stand your ground on the evil day of danger. Do you hear what I'm saying? This is not a clever suggestion that Paul was writing to the church in Ephesus. This is a command of what we need to do. Paul was living under such duress that he feared for his life continually. And he says that God delivered him. When you read through 2 Timothy, all the stuff that he'd been through, he says that God delivered him out of them all. Now, how do you think God just has a special place in his heart for Paul, and that's why he delivered him? No. We all have that same special place in the heart of God. But do we do what we're supposed to do to embrace that deliverance? Friend, I'm telling you how to do it. These sorrowful things, the mind, the battlefield of our mind, you know, laying aside the things that are tripping us up, and recognizing that this battle is a spiritual battle. So what do? I'm telling you right now what you do. You put on your armor. You get on your knees in the morning and you say, Father, I thank you that no weapon formed against me can prosper, that greater is he who is in me than he that's in the world, and that where sin abounds, God, your grace and help does much more abound. That's how you do it. And you recognize, you take authority. When you feel like you're being dragged into an argument or into a fight or into a conflict, stop right then and there. Don't give heed to it from your flesh. Slow down. Look into the Word. Get some scriptures. And then fight it spiritually. Resist the devil and he will flee. If the enemy's not fleeing from you, friend, it's because you're not fighting it properly. You're fighting it from the flesh. You can't fight spiritual battles with your flesh. It's spiritual, and we got to look at it as that. We have the right to take authority over strife, over division, over hatred, over jealousy. We could come against that. And as we come against that and take a stand against it, the enemy has to relinquish. Has to. You know, you may not believe it right now, and if you don't, it's safe to say that we probably have not been fighting it this way. But dare to do it. Step out in faith. Fight the spiritual battle that's before you the way God intended us to fight. And you'll see a completely different result. You'll recognize that this same battering and barrage of stuff that's been plaguing you and you felt like there's no way out from under it will all of a sudden begin to be moved out of your way. Do you trust God? I do. He's my Father. He would never lie to me or never hurt. He gave us His Word. So you know what? I'm going to end it right there because we'll continue again on Sunday, the finishing up of this thing. But I wanted to go over this part of how important it is with our mind, fighting the good fight of faith, recognizing the times that we're living in, and understanding that God has made a way for us to escape every one of these things and challenges. Yes, they're going to come, but if we weren't able to overcome them, He wouldn't have said, be of good cheer. Didn't He tell us that in John chapter 8? He said, listen, in this life, you're going to have problems. He said, but be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. Friend, we have overcome the world because Jesus has. And the greater one lives inside of you. The greater one, nothing greater than God. And He lives in us. So that means you can do it. That means you have already won. That means that victory is yours. Now I'm asking you to press into the things of God, to make His Word your habitation. Please, I'm pouring my heart of the Spirit of God is speaking to you now. This is the time for you to get serious about your walk with the Lord. This is a time for us to rise up in faith and to lay hold of the promises of God. Not a time to play around. Not a time to, I got time still. I'll get around to it. Lord knows I'm only human. That's a cop-out. That's called weak. Get in it. Do it. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Spend time in the Word. Be diligent. Ask for His help, and He will help you. He will help you. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Father, we're thankful for Your Word today. I thank You for the Holy Spirit that has been teaching us today, that every person who has heard the Word today, wherever they're at in this world, on this globe, on this planet, wherever they're at, that the Spirit of God is speaking to their hearts right now, teaching us, encouraging us, helping us. Father, I thank You that Your Word never returns void, but it always accomplishes what it's sent forth to do. You've given us Your Word, Father, and we hold fast to Your Word and to our confession, Father. And we believe You. We believe You. We thank You that what Jesus bore in His body, we no longer need to bear. And that although we were under the curse, Galatians 3:13 tells us that we've been redeemed from the curse of the law, sickness, spiritual death, and destruction. And so, Father, I thank You for healthy, satisfied, prosperous lives of all of Your church and Your children. And I just want to put this out there. I mean, I know we're not in person right now, but our staff is watching on this feed as well. And I like to give everyone an opportunity to receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And if you don't know Him and you don't understand what we're saying, friend, you are not alone. We want to pray for you. We are here for you. And when our doors open again, we can meet with you and encourage you in person. But for now, comment on that feed. Please comment on that feed. If you don't know Jesus and you have never received salvation, friend, you need to do that. You can't risk living another 30 seconds without God, without a know-so experience and relationship with the Master. It's not religion, it's not rules, and it's not regulation. It is relationship. God loves you more than you could ever wrap your head around. God loves you. If you love something so much, God, you can understand love. God loves you so much more than that. And He wants to help you. So please comment on that feed right now. If you're watching it, comment. Let us know that you want help, that you want salvation. Our phone number's on there. You can reach out to the church. You can email the church. We want to pray for you. We want to help you, and we want to encourage you and help you begin this new journey in Christ, because God has a plan and a purpose for your life, and he wants you to be part of this end time revival before he comes and wraps it all up. So please let us know. We're here for you. We love you, and continue to pray for you, and thank God for his best, because the best is still yet to come. So God bless you. We love all of you, and again, continue to look at our website for updates, and I put out some messages, but at least if you're not on that phone call list, you can check out all of our updated, most recent updated information on our website at AbundantGraceChurch.com. Again, you can always partner with us and give 732-856-5050. This is very good ground you're sowing into, because we're doing incredible things for the kingdom of God, and the best is yet to come. God bless you. We love you, and we'll see you again Tuesday morning at 10:30 for our faith and healing class. Have a great rest of your day.